Welcome to everyone this morning, and we're so glad that we can really gather together now and worship. And on this first Sunday in August, as we've been many places, and many of us have been many places, I too am glad to be back with you all so that we can worship together. Thank you for spending this time in worship together with us. Even though we can't all be together in body, we are together in spirit. And thank you for your patience and for finding us here this morning. For thousands of years, Indigenous people have walked on this land, on their own land. Their relationship with the land is at the center of their lives. We acknowledge these lands upon which we worship as the ancestral, cultural, traditional, and unceded lands of the Wabanaki Confederacy, of the Andakana peoples. We commit ourselves to the work of dismantling the legacies of settler colonialism. I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God. We are indeed kin together in God's love and called not to be separate from one another. Jesus' parables, the stories that poke us and wake us up to the separateness that we live, they invite us, no, they really demand of us to live lives of unity with all people and all creation in the oneness that is God. We live lives of value. We are valuable to others. We place value on things, and we may even create value in marketplaces. Our call from God as part of the beloved community is to return value where it has been taken away. And so we have a job that goes beyond all others, a job of great love. Let our lives and this worship be directed to that love, so that we may create together the kingdom of God. And let us sing together. Thank you. God, we indeed gather here in your midst. We gather with whatever we have, wherever we are, with all that we are indeed, God, and all of it is beloved to you. Hear us now as we gather. Open our hearts and our minds to not only you, but also to your world around us. All this we ask in your name. Amen. For our centering prayer today, it is indeed taken, and the theme of it is selected and taken because of our scripture reading this morning, which will be on the story that's always been called the Pearl of Great Price. And I just want to let you know that I am a pearl person. I'm not a diamond person. I am a pearl person. The first jewelry I ever asked for from my parents was a single pearl on a necklace. And it is the most common thing in my collection. I wear a pearl every day on my hand. And as you can see this morning, I brought my longest pearl necklace that I had in my collection, which is actually a new acquisition. I'm very proud of it. And I'm just so pleased. So I'm a pearl person. So this is one of my favorite stories. And we are actually, I believe, called to live pearl lives. I do think it's funny that, you know, they make those necklaces, as I said a couple weeks ago, of little mustard seeds, you know, that people can wear. Why don't we just wear pearls, like the Pearl of Great Price story, right? But we are called to be oysters and live this pearl life, to take irritants and surround them and transform them into something that glows with God's love. This poem reminds me that that work is not an easy task and that we have to do it in so many difficult situations. But it also reveals what is not seen. Because how many of us have oyster shells laying around our house or wear those around our neck? The oyster gives us a gift by showing what's inside of it and bringing it to something that we can wear on the outside and remember and share with others. So this poem this morning, What Makes a Pearl, is for us in whatever way God speaks to us through it this morning. So if you would, ground your feet on whatever ground you are standing on or sitting on, and your seat in whatever seat you have there. And find your breathing. When she died, I took my mother's socks, those fuzzy dotted ones that she'd worn in hospice. I wore them all through the winter. Maybe that's creepy, but is it really so different from the necklace she willed to me? That single pearl clinging to its strand of silver? The necklace isn't creepy. Every day for a year, I hung it over my heart, even in the shower, even when it felt heavy as a beggar's first coin. I want to say that having these things was like having a scar, but worse. In winter, socks are as inevitable as scars, except there's more of a choice in it. When I was cold, I could choose which socks and whose. But I'm wrong. These tokens I harvested from her deathbed are more like the pearl, or rather, what makes a pearl. That piece of sand, the irritant, that the necro builds itself around, that tiny everyday object. That little by little learns to glow. Loving God, this poem makes us think of hard and beautiful things. It makes us think of hard moments when we remember the feet of our loved ones as they were dying, as we remember the gifts that they gave us and the love that they passed down through us. It is hard to remember our losses, God, and yet isn't it beautiful to remember the love? God, in these hard and beautiful lives that we live, may we know that you are present in it, that you are the glow within us, that you are what calls us to share your light, to be your light in this world. God, may we know that those hard things will have layer and layer of love laid upon them, and that you will create them in and recreate them into the beauty that is our lives. All this we ask in your name. Amen.
Kingdom of God and God's righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Alleluia, alleluia. Ask and it shall be given unto you. Seek and ye shall
And a special thank you to Ginny and Rose this morning for being our special music and our choir and just about everything, right? But so glad to have you all with us and sharing your music. And for the children this morning, if you'd gather round, that would be fabulous. I have a question for you this morning. Do you have a favorite thing? A favorite toy or just a favorite object? I know when my daughter was small, she had a favorite rock. And she'd put it on the windowsill of wherever we lived, and that was her favorite rock. And I remember as her mom, I had to be very careful and just remember that it wasn't a rock. It was her favorite rock. I may have just seen it as a rock, but to her, it was the best. Do you have something like that where you just think it's the best thing and maybe your friends don't think it's that great, or maybe if you have a brother or sister, they don't think it's that great, and maybe even your parents don't remember it's that great, but you know it's your favorite. That's what we have in the story today. We have a story about a man who bought and sold pearls. And I'm wearing pearls today. They're not always white, let me tell you. They can be black. I have a string of black pearls, too. They can be pink. They can be purple. They can be blue. It's amazing. All depends on what kind of oyster and where that oyster makes them. Pretty fabulous. But one day, he found the pearl of great value, is what he called it. He just couldn't believe it. And he sold everything he had just so he could have that pearl. Isn't that pretty amazing? But I'll bet some of the other people who also bought and sold pearls were like, now what are you gonna do? You don't have any money. If you think this is the best thing in the world and you're gonna keep it, how are you gonna eat? What are you gonna do? But he didn't care. This was his pearl of great value. This meant a lot to him. And if anybody else couldn't see it, he still could. And I think Jesus tells us this story that each of us, everybody, our job is to find value where other people don't see it. Not just in favorite things that we have, but in other people. Sometimes when people get forgotten or they say, we don't want you on our team or we don't want you to do this, that we can be the ones to say, oh no, they do really important things too. I love them. Because God loves us all. There is nobody that God says, I don't know, I don't love you as much as this one. God never says that. God says, all my love is for everyone. And if we can live like that, we can be doing God's work. So let's do that together. And I hope your favorite thing that you keep special at home reminds you to do just that. Let's pray. Loving God, everybody is your favorite. And that is a wonderful thing that you see everybody as your loved one. Let us do that same. Help us that when somebody's left out, to remember that they are loved just as much as everybody else and to include them. All this we ask in your name. Amen.
Like a child I would send to reveal and to mend, like a child and a friend, Jesus calls. Like a child we may find, claiming God's soul and mind, like a child strong and kind, Jesus comes. Like a child born to pray and to show us the way, like a child here to stay, Jesus calls. Like a child we receive all that love can conceive, like a child we
And our scripture lesson this morning is another one that is short and sweet and to the, I would say to the point, except I'm never so sure that Jesus just has one point. But here is our scripture from Matthew 13, verses 45 and 46. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. May God bless these words to our living. We have been working through the Kingdom of Heaven parables this summer and challenging ourselves to change our wording to kingdom instead of kingdom, to change from a top-down ruling language to a co-creating inclusive language that reminds us that God does not seek to create an autocracy, but rather a beloved community, and that we are co-creators in it. And so far this summer, the kingdom of heaven has been like someone who sowed good seed and then made up a story about the weeds, about a mustard seed, about a woman hiding some yeast, and a treasure hidden in a field. Now it's like a merchant. Not what the merchant buys and sells, but the merchant. We have a tendency to call this story the pearl of great price. But it starts out, as you heard, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant. So it's more like the merchant. And it's a merchant that has a specialty, fine pearls. And we know what a merchant is. We don't use that that language as much, though. Well, I don't think we did. It dropped out of favor, and then Amazon started using it as their online merchants, and we thought of them again. But a merchant is a person who makes their living by the profitable sale of items. You buy low and you sell high. You find what is hard to find. You add the cost of your time and profit, and that's the price. You do this for a while, and you get to know the field. It's not just the exchange of goods that becomes what's valuable in your life. It's the knowledge that you acquire. It is all the places that you know to go and buy, the supply sources that maybe nobody else has dug up or dug around, and maybe even some that you have created. You start to get a new way of seeing things. You get an eye for what is good. I had a conversation with the woman who owns my favorite dress shop in Portland about that. She asked me one day while I was in there, and she said, "Christine, when you go shopping, what's the first thing you do? What's the first thing you look at?" And she says, "Is it color? Is it fabric?" And you could hear, we were two people who had a love of clothing. And we didn't go in looking for a thing. You go in and you look. And so the question is, did you touch first for fabric, or did you look for color and then, or look for style? And we each had a different approach, and it was really fascinating. I go for fabric. I'm touching everything, and I want to see what it feels like. But this merchant is buying and selling, and then finds one of great value. Value. Value is so interesting and so complex. Does a pearl have any value while it's in the oyster? We are the ones that give that pearl value. How many pearls are just lying on the bottom of the ocean that after a certain point, an oyster just spit out? Assigning value. That is redemption. To redeem something is to bring value to it, or to return its value to it. Now, we tend to focus a lot on value. I actually was told the other day, I stopped while on the street, I was on the was walking to Hannaford, and I saw my real estate agent, and he stopped me, and he said, "How you doing, Christine?" And I said, "Oh, pretty good, Peter, you know." I said, "How's business?" He says, "Oh, there's not much on the market, Christine. It's really tough." He says, "If you want to sell your house," which I have owned for 6 whole months now, people, right? 6 months. He said, "I can get you another $30,000 for it than you paid for it." Now, I have done nothing to that house more than move in and fix a toilet. That's it. All our homes have actually risen proportionally. It's not just my little one up the road. And it's only because of COVID and because everybody's unsure and people do want to move up to Maine because, well, we've got it under control, the best, it seems, in the entire country. And we have lots of space and it's a nice life and everything. I did nothing, and yet value rose. Value is complex. But we as people of faith are not about assigning a value. We are about returning value, and that's called redemption. Redemption is one of those 25-cent church words reserved usually for God and Jesus. And as I found out a number of years ago, it seems that most movie themes are also about redemption. I don't know whether you need to work out redemption if you're going to write a movie, but it seems like you have to. But it is a tragedy, and I think a dereliction of our duty as people of faith, that we often leave that work of redemption to God. And I learned about that in the story of Ruth and Naomi. Now, you maybe remember the story of Ruth and Naomi. Ruth gets her own title. She's the only woman in the Bible that gets her own book. But Naomi is actually her mother-in-law. And Naomi has lost her husband and both of her sons, with Ruth being the wife of one of those sons. Now, women alone, without the usual structures of support, have no value in society at that point. I'm not saying that that's just. That is what this story is built on. There were societal laws and expectations of relatives so that no woman would be left without support. And the name of that process is called the rite of redemption. Male relatives had the responsibility of taking widowed women into their homes so that these women had value again. And this was called exercising the rite of redemption. Both Ruth and Naomi returned to Naomi's hometown with all the relatives there. And the guys in town are talking about it, but nobody does anything about it. And Ruth actually pushes that question and makes something happen about it. It's often said the generosity of Boaz, but if you read the story, and I'm not going to repeat all of that she does, she actually does some pretty bold and brazen things to push that question of who is going to be the redeemer in this situation. And Ruth, the daughter-in-law, does just that. And then Boaz sees her bravery and goes to the men that are gathered in the town and says, "Hey, is anybody, y'all are supposed to do this first. I'm like 12th in line. Can I exercise the right of redemption, or is somebody else going to do it first?" And all the guys are like, "Oh, no, please, Boaz, you just go ahead. You take two more mouths into your household. You pay for them. That's fine." And in that rite of redemption, it actually continues because Ruth marries Boaz, the younger one, of course, not Naomi. And when she marries Boaz, she has a baby, a son, actually. And remember now, Naomi has no sons. She has no heirs. She has Ruth, right? And Ruth takes that baby and she places that baby in Naomi's arms, saying, and basically says, by doing that, "This is now your son, not my son." It's not a redemption that Ruth was required to do, but Ruth knew how important it was. The women in town even declared, who had kind of gotten together and said, "Oh, woe is Naomi," though nobody did anything for her, right? The women in town even declared that Naomi now has a child and a son. Naomi went from no value to a mother and the grandmother of King David. That's why Ruth's story is told, is to show this line, as if this line to King David is straight. There's no way it is. But while I'm not fond at all of persons' values being on their ability and willingness to have children, this story brings up really good questions for us, doesn't it? What do we value? What do we value as a society, and how are those rules made? How are some people left out by no fault of their own, but rather by the structures and the societal system that we have devised? How do we value people? And how do we declare others and ourselves useless often? How is value decided? We just had a week in remembering John Lewis and his life's work of taking seriously that first we are all part of the beloved community. I had to just laugh at myself, and then tears rolled down my face. I don't know if some of you saw the specials about John, but he'd go around with his election t-shirts on a lot of times, especially when he was doing those hot dog gatherings for people and feeding people. I loved it. And on the front it said the big words, John Lewis, you know, representative or whatever. Do you see what it says on the back? It had a quote, and in big letters, beloved community, had a quote from Martin Luther King Jr. on it. He repeated it at least as much as MLK Jr. did too. But I think he's the only House of Representatives person I've ever seen with a t-shirt or a poster or anything with the words beloved community on it. And he talked about beloved community all the time. And then second, it was the words of the Declaration of Independence that he took so seriously, that all people are created equal. And I'm just going to do an aside here. I know it's been a long morning already. But if you haven't watched the special on PBS where Henry Gates Jr. finds or goes back and does the family lineage of John Lewis and Cory Booker, please do. Because John Lewis finds out that he is not the first in his family that fought and exercised for voting rights. It's fantastic. He didn't know any of this, and it was such a wonderful thing. So please go and see that. With John's mind, body, and life, he continually confronted the systems of this country that say there are some people better than others, and still say that there are some people more deserving of others. How do we decide value? The real question, though, is, are we deciders of value or redeemers? There is a whole new profession that has been amplified by the internet, and that is the profession of influencer. Years ago, we had it, the wealthy, the movie stars. We just used to call them stylish, and you would follow them, right? And they would be the leaders of style. Now we have influencers. They get people to follow them on their blog and their Instagram, which, just because of my age, because I've used the word Instagram, means it is no longer cool, just to let you know. But they do that because their new job is to get us to buy whatever companies have given to them and ask them and pay them to promote. And unfortunately, I think the job of Christianity, and not just our very more conservative and evangelical brothers and sisters, have been defined that way. The Great Commission: go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them. Get them to buy into this system of belief, and then they will have value, and then they will be redeemed. Have you been saved, is the question. That's what you usually distill down to, just yes or no. You're good if you haven't, you're plus if you have. As I was driving on one of the many miles, I saw on the overpass, you know, usually they put up signs to somebody or welcome home if they're coming back from the military. One said, Jesus or burn. I didn't even know what to do. Just keep on driving. It often, though, gets distilled down to just that kind of choice, and it's not. Even as a child at camp, I was taught the song, "I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb." Oh, you can't get to heaven on roller skates because you'll roll right past those pearly gates. All my sins have been washed away. I've been redeemed. Even the word redemption was co-opted to mean a yes or a no. But redemption is not that easy. It's bringing value back to life. Systems must change so that everything has value. And that's not easy. Changing the word from kingdom to kindom is one way. Kingdom sets up a system where one person is of the most value of anyone. And Jesus didn't even want to be called king. He resists this again and again. Our leaders who profess and hold up the Bible sometimes often ignore those protestations of Jesus that say, "No, I'm not the king." Kingdom reminds us that we're all in this together. And while we're all different, our value is not different. We have to say Black Lives Matter right now because our society is structured to say just the opposite. So what about this pearl and this merchant? A person who makes their living by the profitable sales of others. A merchant of fine pearls who searches out fine pearls, not bad ones, but in the high-end market, it sounds like. And imagine the search, looking at pearl after pearl, white, black, silver, rose, blue, different oysters making different colors. At the time of Jesus, the pearls were all still natural. Culturing of pearls didn't begin until the 1900s, when we forced oysters to make them again and again from us. And the reason we had to do that, of course, in this world is because we decimated the mollusks and the oysters that make pearls. And so this merchant was actually trading with countries like China and Sri Lanka. Can you imagine? We forget that. The trading happened all over. That this pearl merchant was international. Imagine all the pearls he looked at in his career. How would you know which one is the pearl? Who was telling you that? Was it rare, so that only a few might be able to own it? Was it a certain color, a certain size? How would you decide? What do you have in your life that you value, as I ask the kids, that others might pass right by? Was the merchant finding what no one else had that was important? Or was it that he was redeeming the pearl, that he was seeing value, that he was giving value, and he was being willing to give up what he had to redeem that pearl? Did others look at that pearl and say, "That one? Why?" And I have another question. When the merchant sold everything to buy the pearl, was he still a merchant? 2 weeks ago, we had the man who found a treasure in a field and sold everything to buy it. That makes a little more sense. He has the land, he has the treasure, and he can work the land and produce food and everything for his family. But when you're looking for a pearl and you sell everything to buy it, how are you going to buy your next meal? How are you going to pay the mortgage? And I love this story, not only because I love pearls, but because it tells us what redemption is really about. It's not about being saved. It's about being willing to be redefined so that all can have value. It's often called the pearl of great price. The merchant who pays the great price is no longer a merchant. That's the price. This merchant did not lose his value in redeeming the pearl, even if he gives up his title as merchant. The kingdom of heaven is like a merchant who takes on a new life, that of redeemer rather than merchant. He goes from transactional to transformational. Transactional works with established goals and boundaries. If you're a transactional leader, it's about getting the status quo done and keeping it that way. Transformational leadership focuses on motivating and engaging followers with a vision for the future. I am tired of transactional. I know we need some. I still pay my bills. I don't have any problem with that. I do those things that we sometimes call paying the rent, right? But if all we do is focus on paying the bills and those tasks with those small outcomes, we die. Transformational is about challenging the status quo. The future is not about past requirements, but rather doing more. And the pearl is a great symbol, an irritant turned beautiful. If we want to know what we need to transform as people of faith, let's look to see what irritates us. Not spit it out, but what do we need to take that? First, figure out why it irritates us. Often it's not an irritating thing, we just think it is. But keep layering and layering God's love on it and learning how to turn things beautiful. We can't do that just inside here. This could be our oyster, couldn't it? If we just did it inside here, what would anybody see? But the glow of these walls, the glow of even our insularness sometimes is this congregation that we call First Parish. We need to be willing to take things and layer them in other places so that they can be seen. Zoom and this coronavirus has pushed us to do just that. But what more do we need to do? We will really have the chance. I still think this, at least this school year, this next school year, 2020 through 2021, is still going to be a very COVID year. And I'm thinking about that for the church, too. We're still going to need to function in this way until at least, I'm thinking, September of next year. But what is it teaching us? What are those irritating things that we need to layer and layer upon and turn into something of beauty? What have we valued and felt like we can assign value to? And we now need to become more. We need to become redeemers. We need to bring value back to things that have been told they have no value. What can we do? What roles do we need to give up so that we can take on the role of Redeemer and so that all can know, especially those that are put in our paths, but all can know that they have equal and complete value in the eyes of God and in our eyes too. Two little verses. Where the merchant becomes a redeemer. This is our call in two little verses, that we move from who we are into a new group of redeemers. Let us do that together. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you. And what a great way to walk into communion with this morning, to enter into it with yes, Jesus loves us. There is no question. It is not just this table that tells us this. It is not just the bread and the juice that tells us this. It is the Bible, the stories of people for decades and centuries and millennia that tells us that. But it is also us. It is our job to be singing that song of, yes, Jesus loves you in this world, in everything that we do. And no one is kept from this table. Everyone is always welcome. Unsure of what it means, yes, you are welcome too. A tradition that you have been participating for more decades than you want to admit, yes, you are welcome too. People who don't even know and are just hungry and thirsty, oh yes, especially you too. Come. For not only is everything ready, everything is always ready. For the table is this world. And let us gather together in God's love. And indeed, the night that Jesus gathered the disciples together, when Jesus knew it was going to be difficult, it had been difficult, and it wasn't going to stop. And he may even know that it was going to get even worse. Because I think Judas could not keep a secret, and those plans to have Jesus arrested were well known. But Jesus still gathered everybody around the table, Judas too, everybody, and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Every time you eat, remember what I'm calling you to do." And at the end of the meal, Jesus took the cup and he said, "This is the cup of blessing that we share. Now this cup is my blood poured out for you. That is my new blessing. Every time you are thirsty, every time you take a drink, remember, I'm calling you to do the same. Pour yourself out." And so we gather at whatever tables we are. I love that we get to join all our tables together at this time. We get to make every place that we are a place of communion. So let's gather together, for all are indeed welcome. You have your bread. All these ingredients have been gathered together by many people in many places. It doesn't matter what we eat. It matters that we think of those who brought us here, those who have gone before us, whether we knew them or not, those who made this even bit of whatever we have possible, that we celebrate that together as God working in our lives. Indeed, let us eat together. Loving God, hear our prayers. This cup is a cup of blessing, which means it needs to be a cup of justice. Justice for those who picked the grapes, for those who whatever you have today, who were a part of making that happen and are often not paid justly or treated justly. Justice is a blessing, not just for those who are without it, but for all of us. And when we live that together, we will know God's love. Let us drink together in that opportunity, and job. See the coffee cups go up. Loving God, indeed, hear our prayers. Amen. And we have been together now, and we have heard the words that we need to be more than just what we thought we have been. The items and the committees and the different things that we do here, we need to be redeemers. So in that way, how will you become the mission of being a redeemer this week? How will you, as you bring value and show value to people in this world, be a redeemer? For that is what we are called to be. And thank you for bringing your gifts and offerings, those that what we usually say has value, but they only have value when we see their value in us using them to bring value to this whole world, to be a part of God's redemption of those who think that they are without value. So let us offer our gifts together as to be redeemers in this world. Loving God, for these gifts and so many that we offer today in this your world, we are thankful. God, for the call that you give us, not to hoard those gifts, not to consider them ours, but consider them only as the means by which we share your love and redeem folks in this world. God, send us with just that goal. All this we ask in your name. Amen. As we gather together with what is on our hearts and minds, may we remember all of those who are special to us, those that we have seen and heard names and faces that we may not know but touched us in some way, and for those whose names are not even known, for those who are sure they are forgotten, let us make room for them and let them, and may God let them know that they are remembered and loved. Let us pray together. Gracious God, we come to you on this day and on this morning as your people of love, as your people who seek to be your love. We hear your call in so many ways. Sometimes we hear it loudly and we want to ignore it. Sometimes we hear it softly and it draws us close. Sometimes, God, we just turn our ears off and don't even want to know. And sometimes, God, our ears ache to hear your words again and again, spoken to us through the words and deeds of others, even spoken in that still small way within our hearts. God, you never leave us alone, and we are thankful. Keep bothering us into being your people. Keep loving us into being your light. God, we think of that this morning, that your need for us to be your light and love in this world has not been diminished by all the work that people have done over the millennia. We know that this job is endless, that there is plenty of room for everyone. God, forgive us when we create the division that needs to be healed. Forgive us, God, when we step back from the work of healing. And God, strengthen and empower us in those times when we step forward and we feel like we don't know what we're doing. But God, we step with you. We step in love. And so it is your doing. And we pray for those who we've called to lead us in this world. We pray that they may step out in your courage and love, that the warring ways of this world may be ended, that the idea that there's only a limited amount of value and it must be hoarded by a few and taken away from many, God, may that idea end and may we stop it. May we proclaim that you are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, and that we don't even begin to understand the eternalness of you. God, may that immenseness make us generous beyond belief. May we scare ourselves in finding out just how much we can do. And then may we step forward in your courage. God, for the leaders that are coming up among us, those who are young and age and active in spirit and power, may we let them lead us. May we be willing to see their wisdom at their age. And may we join in their love. God, for those whose voices need to be heard and they think no one is listening, may people be sent to amplify their voice, not step in front, but hold them up. Repeat what they say. Make real their love. God, may we be some of those people too. God, in all the places that we know, in this town and in many, where systems need to be redeemed, where they value some people over others, God, may that end. May we, in our privilege, dismantle those. And may we find your freedom. Just as your table that we ate at this morning, God, does not get smaller and more crowded as people come, but more expansive and more beautiful, may we find that in this world. May we know that good work. May we do that good work. And for those right close to us, God, may we reach out. May we care for those who are grieving. We think of so many in our congregation that have lost loved ones at this time when we are supposed to be distant. But we know, God, those loved ones are not distant to them. be with them in these days of walking and healing, of an openness to their grief and that healing. Loving God, for those who rejoice, for all those that have had new life in their families, whether that is the bringing on or the birthing of someone new, or finding a new friend, a new way to be, a new purpose. God, may we be indeed your redeemers of all in this world. Hear us now as we do the incredible, as we join our voices and our lives and our hearts together and pray together words that you call us to. Loving God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And let's sing together our final hymn, Swing Low, Sweet Chariot. It is a blessing indeed that we are called to serve. It is not a burden that we have to do in our daily lives or in this week ahead. It is a blessing. And so let us gather together and let us bless this world in our service. And may God's peace be with you now and always. Amen. Thank you. Thank you all for being with us this morning, and you are welcome to unmute yourself, and thank you again for your patience this morning with all of that. And I have to tell you how wonderful it was during communion. I saw a coffee cup and a juice cup and all different kinds of things that you guys were doing. But thank you again for your patience this morning, and it's good to be back.